A full-fledged parliamentary system of government with a modern institutional framework was established in the country with the coming into force of the Republic Constitution in 1950. Yet, democratic traditions and institutions were not unknown to India even earlier. Dating back to the Vedic period, circa 3000 to 1000 BC, popular assemblies and elected monarchs had been in vogue in the country. And for nearly 16 centuries, circa 1000 BC to 600 AD, a republican form of government flourished in many parts of the country. Mahatma Gandhi was an inspiration behind the People's Parliament. In his words, "Under democracy, individual liberty of opinion and action is jealously guarded."
Long years ago, we made a tryst with destiny, and now the time comes when we shall redeem our pledge. At the stroke of the midnight hour, when the world sleeps, India will awake to life and freedom.
On attaining independence on August 15, 1947, the Constituent Assembly assumed full powers for the governance of the country. "We, the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular democracy republic, and to secure to all its citizens justice, social, economic, and political, liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship, equality of status and of opportunity, and to promote among them all fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity and integrity of the nation. In our Constituent Assembly, this 26th day of November 1949, do hereby adopt, enact, and give to ourselves this Constitution." In 1946, our Constituent Assembly started framing the Constitution. The Constitution was adopted by the Constituent Assembly in the name of the people of India on 26th of November 1949. It finally came into force on 26th of January 1950 when India became a republic. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, the great social reformer, eminent lawyer, and political leader, was the chairman of the drafting committee of the Constitution. Some of our brightest stars in the galaxy of freedom fighters remind us of the long fight for freedom and the emergence of a glorious nation. Rajaji declared on 26 January 1950 that India, that is Bharat, shall be a sovereign democratic republic, and the Union and its constituents shall exercise all powers and sanctions of government and administration within the provisions of the Constitution. The Constituent Assembly of India was transformed as the first Parliament of Free India, which continued until the first general elections held in 1952. The first elected President of India was Dr. Rajendra Prasad, who has also presided over the Constituent Assembly. The first Prime Minister, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. the president appoints other ministers on the advice of the prime minister. The other presidents were Dr. S. Radhakrishnan, Dr. Zakir Hussain, V. V. Giri, Fakhruddin Ali Ahmad, and Dr. Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy. A presidential candidate can be any Indian citizen of not less than 35 years of age and eligible for election as a member of the Lok Sabha. Gyani Zail Singh was elected as the president in 1982. The constitution gives the president all executive powers, including the supreme command of the armed forces. He is the constitutional head of the country and represents the nation. A fond farewell to an ex-president. The Rajya Sabha is a permanent body. It consists of representatives from the states. The elected members of state assemblies, MLAs, elect members of the Rajya Sabha in accordance with the system of proportional representation. One-third of the members retire every second year. The minimum age for membership is 30 years. The tenure of every member is 6 years. The present strength of the Rajya Sabha is 244. Out of these, 12 are nominated by the president for their special knowledge or practical experience in literature, science, art and social service. The Rajya Sabha plays an important role in making laws for the country. The vice president, elected by the members of both houses of parliament for 5 years, is the ex officio chairman of the Rajya Sabha. In the absence of the chairman, the deputy chairman presides over the sittings of Rajya Sabha. R. Venkataraman, the vice president. During the absence of the president, the vice president discharges his functions until the president resumes his duties. Vice President Dr. S. Radhakrishnan, followed by Dr. Zakir Hussain, V. V. Giri, G. S. Pathak, B. D. Jatti, and M. Hidayatullah. The Election Commission prepares the electoral rolls and is responsible for the conducting of fair and free elections. During the short span of about 3 decades, India has held several general elections in a free and peaceful manner involving hundreds of millions of people. This experiment with the electorate, perhaps the largest in any democracy, proves beyond doubt the political maturity and robust sense of responsibility of the people of India. It also proves the confidence and faith of the democratic processes and the representative institutions in our country. Members of the Lok Sabha are directly elected by the people. The voting is on the basis of adult suffrage by those who have reached 21 years of age. Of the Lok Sabha under the present law is 544. Some seats are reserved for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. 2 members of the Anglo-Indian community are nominated by the president. The term of the Lok Sabha is 5 years unless dissolved earlier. Thank you. After the election, it is time for the majority party to elect its leader. The leader, capable of commanding a majority in the Lok Sabha, is invited by the president to be the prime minister. In a parliamentary democracy, the prime minister, as the representative of the people, is the most powerful person. Members of the 7th Lok Sabha. Our prime ministers have been Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Lal Bahadur Shastri, Indira Gandhi, Morarji Desai, Charan Singh, Indira Gandhi, and now Rajiv Gandhi. The members of the 8th Lok Sabha, constituted on 31st of December 1984, elected Sri Rajiv Gandhi as their leader.
We have true faith and allegiance.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
To the Constitution of India.
To the Constitution of India.
As by law established.
As by law established.
That I will uphold.
That I will uphold.
The sovereignty and integrity of India.
The sovereignty and integrity of India.
Is getting prepared for its winter session. This most magnificent building in New Delhi has one of the brightest clusters of architectural gems possessed by any country in the world, where the representatives of the people of India meet. It was inaugurated in 1927. An annexe was added in 1975. Open the door to thy people, and let us see thee for the obtaining of sovereignty. This reminds one of the sovereignty of the nation, of which Parliament is the visible symbol. Each year, Parliament has usually three sessions: budget session, monsoon session, and winter session. But the Rajya Sabha has a break of about a month during budget session, when the Lok Sabha discusses and votes demands for grants of various ministries. Most of our states have distinct linguistic, cultural, and racial identities of their own. This is why our country is said to represent unity in diversity. After election, a member of parliament represents the country as a whole. With all our different traditions of caste, religion and customs, we have been functioning harmoniously in parliament. The proceedings of parliament are conducted in Hindi or English, but a member can speak in any of the 15 languages specified in the 8th schedule to the constitution. Arrangements are made for simultaneous interpretation. The ministers can be from any House of Parliament. Any person who is not a member of Parliament can also be appointed as a minister, but he must get elected to either house within 6 months. Otherwise, he ceases to be a minister. The Council of Ministers, which runs the administration of the country, is collectively responsible to Lok Sabha. The Prime Minister receives an affectionate welcome on arrival at Parliament House. And so, into the corridors of Parliament House. Everywhere, a reminder of great lives dedicated towards achieving a free India, a truly democratic country, where the message of peace must be followed relentlessly. The new members are welcomed. On the first day, members take an oath administered to them by Speaker Pro Tem. By convention, the senior-most member of Lok Sabha is appointed Speaker Pro Tem by the President. Next day, the Speaker is elected. Dr. Balram Jakhar, Speaker of the 8th Lok Sabha, meets the press. The highest tradition of impartiality and fairness established by the first speaker, G.V. Mavlankar, have been jealously preserved and further strengthened by his illustrious successors. G.V. Mavlankar, M. Anantashayanam Ayyangar, Hukum Singh, M. Sanjeev Reddy, G.S. Dhillon, Baliram Bhagat, A.S. Hegde.
India has had a long democratic heritage. Parliamentary system, which we gave to ourselves after attaining independence, has survived many vicissitudes. Our democratic process has shown both resilience and ingenuity in tackling the manifold challenges of building up a new society in keeping with our national ethos. India's impressive record of political stability and the achievements in socio-economic spheres bear eloquent testimony to the acceptance of the parliamentary system as a way of life by our people. This is so only because the system itself derives its authority from the constitution, but more important, it continues to echo the urges and aspirations of the masses in this country.
Each House of Parliament has a Secretary General who is a permanent officer of the House. Secretary General Lok Sabha, Secretary General Rajya Sabha. Vitalbhai Patel, who presided over the Provisional Parliament before the first general elections. Lok Sabha Chamber. The Speaker, or in his absence, the Deputy Speaker, who is also elected by the House, presides over the sittings of the Lok Sabha. If you're wondering why the Parliament chambers are shown empty, it is because the filming of the Houses at work is not permitted. Parliament enjoys very wide powers. It can pass legislation on all matters of national importance assigned under the Constitution. It can even amend the Constitution if that is the wish of the majority of its members in either House and two-thirds of the members present and voting. It also passes the budget of the Union Government. Besides legislation, Parliament has two other cardinal functions: provision of finances and surveillance of the executive. But more fundamental is its representational role. It is the supreme national forum through which the urges and aspirations, the feelings and anxieties, and even the joys and sorrows of the people are articulated. The first hour of the day's sitting, exclusively set apart for asking and answering of questions, is undoubtedly the most interesting and exciting part of the proceedings. The other means through which members bring matters of urgent public importance before the House are adjournment motions, calling attention, short duration discussions, and special mentions. In extreme cases, a no confidence motion may be moved against the government. Thank you. case of a deadlock between the two houses over the provisions of a bill, the President can summon a joint sitting of the two houses for consideration of the bill. From 1952 onwards, our Parliament has enacted 2,168 acts. Acts which contribute to the efficient governance of this vast country, ushering in great reforms in social, economic, political and various other fields. As the work done by Parliament is varied and the time at its disposal is limited, a good deal of its business is transacted in the committees. There are standing committees and ad hoc ones. Each house has a number of standing committees which acts as Parliament's watchdogs over the executive. In all these committees, the opposition is given proportional representation. Both houses have a business advisory committee and several other committees. On the floor of the Parliament, discussions are likely to be on party lines and often generate heated arguments. But in the committees, members can be more cordial and responsive. The Lok Sabha has a number of other committees in addition. Estimates, public accounts, public undertakings, welfare of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. Among these, the financial committees keep a vigil on governmental spending and performance. The Public Accounts Committee, Estimates Committee and Committee on Public Undertakings fall into the group. The chairman of the Public Accounts Committee is from the opposition. Here we are in the Central Hall. This hall of the Parliament House is one of the most attractive architectural creations in the country. And its dome is said to be one of the most magnificent domes in the world. The historic transfer of power from the British to Indian hands took place here in 1947. Our constitution was also framed in this hall. Portraits of some of the important freedom fighters are unveiled in this hall. Special occasions, this hall becomes the venue of important, memorable parliamentary activities. It is in this historic hall that visiting foreign dignitaries address the members of Parliament. The ceremony and pageantry associated with such events leave a lasting impression on those who witness them. Parliament consists of the President and two houses, Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha. The President addresses both houses at the beginning of the first session of the year. He summons and prorogues the houses and dissolves Lok Sabha. He assents to bills passed by the two houses, recommends the introduction and consideration of money bills and financial bills, and sees that the budget is presented each year. Two most exciting days of the year for the members and the public are when the railway and finance ministers present the annual budgets to Parliament. In a parliamentary democracy, the press is the fourth limb. It acts as a channel of communication between the people and the Parliament. Through the press, people know what their representatives do for them in Parliament. It also makes members of Parliament aware of the difficulties and grievances of the people. Democratic institutions have wholeheartedly devoted themselves to the task of national reconstruction. But the task is not over. Many challenging tasks still remain to be accomplished. Republic Day is the birthday of the Indian Republic. It is a day for rejoicing of faith in the ideals entrusted in Constitution, in the unique diversity of the people of India and their peaceful coexistence, pledging for making the country stronger and more united day by day. Thank you.